So I am Jean-Pierre Changer. I am honorary professor at the Pasteur Institute and at the Collège de France in Paris. And I have been working all my life at the Institut Pasteur, starting for my PhD thesis with Jacques Monod, and then still working and having experiments being done and discussion going on. And I have been teaching at the Collège de France since 1976. So it means that I was teaching for 30 years. And all my work was dedicated to basically molecular biology. I started with the concept of allosteric protein. This was the outcome of my thesis work. Then I went to United States to the laboratory of David Nartmanson in particular, and I shifted from molecular biology of bacteria to the molecular biology of the nervous system, and start to work on neurotransmitter receptors. Then I came back to the Institut Pasteur and did the early work on the identification of the acetylcholine nicotinic receptor, which is the first receptor for neurotransmitter which was ever isolated. This was in 1970. Then I continued to develop some theories and experimental work on the development of the system, nervous system, and in particular the notion of selective stabilization of synapses, which was followed up by Jerry Edelman as a neural Darwinism. So this was also a very important issue about the relationship between the genome and the phenotype of the brain. I, of course, continued the work on the nicotinic receptor. I'm still working on it, but we discovered in between that there are receptors in bacteria which are highly homologous to the nicotinic receptor, and therefore we have no access to the X-ray structure and the allosteric transition of these receptors. So I started an allosteric transition. I am finishing, if I may say, on an allosteric transition. And last but not least, for decades, I have been working with Stanislas Dehaene, who was a student in my lab, and we have developed some modeling of cognitive function, and we are still working on that. And the most important theory, if I may say, that we did was a theory on the global neuronal workspace, which is a theory which attempts to relate the some particular organization of the brain with access to consciousness. So I am working today from the atomic structure of receptor up to access to consciousness, and of course all this is done in the optic of the neurotransmitter receptors being to my opinion some key components of all neural networks. So that's where I am. And as you can see, it covers a large spectrum of scientific approaches, but I like that. Well, this is, first of all, I have a theory, as usually. I'm repeating myself, but I always work like that. So I had this in my thesis. It was a challenge. So I had to find a way to approach the case of pharmacological receptors. Well, this was a concept that became aware of, which was proposed by Langley in 1905 from his work on the neuromuscular junction, that there were some substances in living organisms which bind the neurotransmitters, the molecules which are involved in intercellular communication in the brain, and then transduce the signal into a physiological action. So I was aware of that, but the question came if I wanted to really demonstrate that this receptor, which was unknown at the time, was an allosteric protein, then I had to identify it first. And I had in my early times in marine laboratory, in Arcachon in particular, I had learned about the work of David Nachman-Sahn on electric fish. And as you may know, these electric fish are having organs which produce huge electric discharge. And I already knew that these electric fish are a collection of synapses, extremely rich in the components of the synapse. And therefore, I had the information from David Nachman-Sahn's work that there were tissues which could be very appropriate to identify a pharmacological receptor. So after my thesis ended, I started to work on acetylcholine esterase, which is an enzyme which breaks down acetylcholine, which is extremely abundant in the electric organ, and did some experiment there. I thought that perhaps it was related to the receptor, or that there were common features, but this was very uncertain. And I went to do my first postdoc with John Gerhardt, who had been working on aspartate transcarbamylase, initially with Arthur Pardy. And he was then working with Howard Chartman in Berkeley. So I did some work to demonstrate, if I may, well, or to support the mono-Wyman change model. And after a year, I said, well, why not I take the opportunity of my visit to United States to start working on the receptor. And on the way to Berkeley, I had stopped to New York. I gave a seminar in David Nachman-Sahn laboratory, and he invited me to come to visit his lab and do some experiment there. So I had done this work on aspartate transcarbamylase in Berkeley, and I thought that it was good for me to just visit him for a few months before I go back to France. And that's what I did. And then there I started to work more closely on the electric organ of fish. And this was the Electrophorus electricus, the electric eel. And I learned to dissect the single cells from the electric organ, which are called electroplech. And actually, I remember having met Steve Kufler, who was professor in Harvard, and said, what have you been doing in David Nachman-Sahn's laboratory? I said, I've been doing electrophysiology. Oh, why do you go to biochemistry lab to learn electrophysiology? Go to my lab, not to his lab. But I said, well, the thing I want to do is to try to have the physiology of the cell with which I am going to do the biochemistry, just to compare in vivo and in vitro with the same system. And we, this is what David Narpenson had established with the electric organ. He had developed the dissection of the single electroplate and the recording by electrophysiological techniques of the electrical response of the electroplate to acetylcholine, to nicotinic compound, and the blocking of nicotinic agonist by curare, which was working, and so on and so forth. So I had, in fact, learned a way to establish the closest relationship between the physiology and the biochemistry. I wanted to link physiology and biochemistry. So I came back to the Pasteur Institute and I introduced the electric fish in the Pasteur Institute. And Jacques Monod was very happy of that. Actually, I was still in his department, but I had an independent laboratory, of course. And I started working on that. I continued working on that. And I developed an in vitro system of membrane fragments purified from the electric organ, which were able to close, like liposomes, make closed vesicles. And then with Michiki Kazai, who was my first Japanese postdoc, we were able to demonstrate that when fill the microsac with radioactive ion, like radioactive potassium or sodium ion, then exposing to acetylcholine or mixing with acetylcholine cause a release of the potassium ion. So we were, in fact, able to have a system of membranes in vitro which respond to the neurotransmitter. And the interesting thing is that the physiology of these microsacs was the same as the physiology of the electroplate. So I was able to make the first connection between in vivo and in vitro. Then the next step was to isolate the protein which responded to acetylcholine in the macrosacs. And I tried to, with difficulties, to solubilize it and develop a binding test by dialysis, equilibrium dialysis, and I had the first evidence for myself that we had isolated a protein which was binding acetylcholine, curare, and which was with the specificity of the electroplate and the microsacs, which was not lost during solubilization by the oxycholate. But we had not the proof. There were many competing labs, and I was almost certain that nobody would believe us. So we need a real proof that this protein was the receptor. And when we were working in the lab, one day I had a phone call from a Chinese scientist from Taiwan, Shen Yuan Li. And he said to me, well, I want to discuss with you the issue of acetylcholine esterase, you know, and the receptor. And I think I have developed a tool which should results in the clear distinction between the receptor and the esterase. I said, what it is. So I was doing an experiment at that time with my hands. And I said, well, let me finish the experiment and then we can discuss. So he waited for 2 hours, came to my lab, and then he said, well, these are toxins which are present in the venom of snakes, like Bungarus multicinctus, and these snakes have developed this toxin to paralyze their prey. And they are binding exquisitely, according to the experiment we have, to the nicotinic receptor at the neuromuscular junction. And I said, well, that's exactly what I need. Please send me the toxin, and I shall try to use the electroplaque, the microsacs, and the extract I had solubilized. 2 weeks after I received the toxin, and everything worked. So the toxin blocked the response to carbamylcholine or acetylcholine on the electroplaque, on the microsac, and it blocked the binding of decamethonium, which was a radioactive nicotinic agonist, to this extract. And one could eliminate this binding by digesting the extract with a protease, so it was a protein. And we also showed that it was a rather large molecule in this very first experiment. And that was it. So we wrote the paper, and in a few weeks, the work was done. And Jacques Monod was extremely critical, of course, with that. He read it. We made some modification of our text and accepted it for PNAS. So that was the first publication of the effect of bungarotoxin as a tool to identify the nicotinic receptor in vitro with the fish electric organ. Yeah, that's an interesting start, because I had read the book by Jacques Monod. He wrote after he started to teach at the Collège de France, because he became professor at the Collège de France. And this book was Le hasard et la nécessité, or Chance and Necessity. And this is a general book on molecular biology, which had a very big impact in France and throughout the world, also in the United States. And this was a general book on the regulation of enzyme biosynthesis, also on allostery, and at the end of the book, it was some kind of scientific and philosophical book on molecular biology, and its generalization to systems, and in particular to the nervous system at the end. And the last chapter of the book was on the brain, and he had a very inneistic view, in the sense that he knew about Hubel and Wiesel work on the brain, and the one on the description of the cells, the neurons in the visual cortex, which are selective to light, and so on and so forth. And from that, he came out with a very inneistic view of the organization of the brain. And he did not discuss so much learning. And therefore, I was a little bit shocked by that and say, well, I think he has not viewed something. So I may say that it was also for me some kind of challenge not a rivalry, but to think about something that he had not thought about. And I, in fact, was aware myself of the work of Torsten Wiesel on the effect of closing an eye on the organization of golems in the cerebral cortex, and I thought that in fact the establishment of the connectivity in the developing system would operate through some kind of trial and error with outgrowth of connection and then pruning and selection of some of the connections which were selected by the activity of the developing network. So this was some kind of, if I may say, Darwinian mechanism, but epigenetic, not really genetic mechanism. So this was also based on observations which were already made on the neuromuscular junction, where at some stage of development, there are more synapses than there are in the adult in the same system. For instance, at the neuromuscular junction, where you have in the adult one axonal fiber and one muscle fiber, you know, there is one axon ending on the end plate, and there is only one end plate for the classical case in the muscle fiber. Then when you look at the newborn, you find by electrophysiological methods several responses. So it means that there are several nerve endings. And then they are eliminated. So the proposal I made was that there was a selection mechanism which was taking place. And I built a mathematical theory of that with Philippe Courage and Antoine Danchin. And it built up as some general learning process during development which is able to store the signals from the environment. And I tested it with the neuromuscular junction by modifying the state of activity of the neuromuscular synapse at early stage of development and show that, for instance, it interferes with the elimination of the supernumerary synapses, so that the pruning was under the control of the state of activity of the synapse. And this has been done by other groups as well, by Lichtman and others. So this kind of theory I'm still having interest in this theory about the development of the brain, for instance, at a later stage, like learning the written language, which is something which is acquired by humanity maybe 7,000 or 8,000 years ago. And this discovery of reading and writing, in fact, has profoundly changed our brain. And there are circuits which are involved in reading and writing, which are, according to my view, being selected through development when the child, around 5 or 6 years old, is learning from the environment. So this view has also been developed by as I said, by Jerry Edelman in a theory of group selection, and meaning that there are some particular ways of learning during development, which I would say are not Lamarckist, but Darwinian, in the sense that there is pre-existing variability, which is taking place through development, and then decrease of the variability through the selection of synaptic patterns. I think this is something which is perhaps linked with the training I had at school, in the elementary school, at the lycée, we say in France. And I had several masters at that time. And one of them was very important for me. I was 11, between 11 and 14. I followed his course, and he found that I was very much interested in living organisms, in natural sciences. He encouraged me a lot, and I think it's thanks to him that I started a career scientific career in biology, because my family was a very simple family, has no special interest in science or in art, whatever, or in philosophy. So thanks to this professor, I received a very elaborate training, and I'm very grateful to him. And in particular, he was very strong on looking for general theories in biology. So the unity of living organisms, the unity of the plan of organization, the laws of evolution, and all these things. So I learned that when I was 13. And he was actually teaching a course which was very, very rare and exceptional even in France, where he was speaking to an audience of youngsters as if we were at the faculty, the university. It was a very enthusiastic moment I had at that time. And since then, I have always been very much concerned by theory. And this is nothing special, if I may say, because when you read Claude Bernard or when you read Pasteur, you find that, as Pasteur said, chance is successful only to prepared minds, which means that when you do an experiment and that you find a new thing, it's not by chance that you discover the new thing. It's because your brain was ready to make the discovery, and that you had the idea in your brain. So I always was attracted by theory, as I mentioned. When I work with De Duve and Brachet, I already developed a theory about fertilization and so on and so forth. And with Jacques Monod, it was really a pleasure for me, because he was exactly, the master I was looking for. And with him, it was not only an exchange about how did you do the experiment and what were the conditions of reproducibility, which was okay, of course, with him, but also to try to theorize and spend a lot of time to have this exchange with him. And this was, if I may say, reinforced. And I may say that in the biological sciences now, The impact of theory is very small, and too small to my taste. And I think there should be more not only speculation, but elaboration of organized concepts, you know, just new concepts that you try to write down, and if possible, to elaborate a mathematical model of them. So the first time was with David Nachmanson in 1967. As I mentioned before, this was a very critical moment for me, going from strict molecular biology of proteins, moving to the nervous system and to the receptors. That's where I learned about the electroplaque and the electric organ. So I went here in September 1967 and worked for a few weeks on these systems, and also wrote papers, and had a very good time in the MBL. In particular, I met Albert Saint-Georgi, who was extremely interested by allosteric proteins, because he was thinking of applying the concept to muscle contraction, and which I think is perfectly okay, still up to date. And I had also very interesting exchange with electrophysiologists like Kenneth Cole, who was doing work on the squid giant axon, and very interestingly, I was classified in a category which was distinct from the one he was belonging to. And I have never been considered as belonging to the electrophysiologist. And as you may know, in the study of the brain, there are really different communities, if I may use the word. And the dominant one for years were, at that time, the anatomist and the physiologist. And the biochemists were not very strong. And I may say that here at MBL, the dominant community was the electrophysiologist. And David Nachmanson was not considered as being part of this community, because he was basically a biochemist. And I was also labeled as a biochemist or a pharmacologist and not as an electrophysiologist. So it has been a real challenge for me throughout all my life to convince the electrophysiologists that the work we were doing on the molecular biology of receptors was really of interest. I think now it's accepted, but at that time it was not. And so it was some kind of interesting challenge for me to try to reconcile, in fact, the two approaches, as I said before, you know, to have all together the physiology and the biochemistry, and subsequently the molecular biology through the cloning and sequencing of the receptors, to have it in harmony with the electrophysiologist's work, even the single channel work which they developed at that time. So I think it's an interesting it's an interesting debate, which is still existing, I think. And we should not, as biochemists, work in isolation. You know, it's we have to work in relation with the function. Function is a physiology. So we do, if you wish, the biochemistry of the physiological response which are recorded in the brain or in axons or whatever. I may say that being a marine biologist at the beginning, I am at home here. That's the first thing. And because I like to continue to learn about marine biology and zoology, if I may say, which I was trained when I was 19. So I like that. The second aspect is that, in addition to the discussion I may have with Jerry Weissman, I found it extremely interesting for me to attend some of the conferences which are done for the courses. And you know, there is a broad diversity of interest here. And that's extremely interesting for me, going from molecular biology to ecology, with developmental biology and ecology or whatever. And this is extremely enriching for me because it gives me the opportunity not only to learn about this discipline or the ongoing work, but also to discuss it with the scientists themselves. And there is it's a very unique place in the sense that even in 3 or 4 weeks, I am meeting a very large number of outstanding scientists, which is for me a very, very important aspect of my scientific life. And last, I love to work in the library, surrounded by all these books, even though I don't use the books very much, but it's a very nice environment. And I may say that when I work here, I am very pleased to see that I am making progress. So, it's a very stimulating environment. And for me, it's becoming something necessary. You know, if I have not been here for 2 or 3 weeks, then when I come back home, I am not satisfied. So this is really, for me, extremely important to visit MPN.